First of all, welcome. This is an interest session on the festival caller. To my left, we have the number one, the indisputable number one caller in the country. From someplace west of Boston, Mass., a little town called Texas, Mr. Marshall Flippo. My name is Kip Garvey. I currently live in California. That's a suburb of Texas. Ooh. We're here simply to discuss some of the various aspects of becoming a festival caller, or as an active festival caller, some of the current trends in festivals that are requiring us to make perhaps some alterations in the presentation of our material, or to make some alterations contractually. Whatever general aspects are concerned are based around the festival caller. I suppose a quick definition would be the man who can't make it in his home area, goes out on the road, becomes a festival caller. That's not so funny, is it? At any rate, we do have a handout here that tries to define for you some general parameters of a festival and some aspects of our profession as callers as they pertain to calling festivals. Some of this information was gathered and collected at prior meetings at Caller Lab by the full-time professional callers and some prior meetings that we have had regarding festival callers. They are certainly not the final word. What you have here is simply an outline, a parameter. They simply take us, point us in the right direction. It is not gospel, what you have in front of you. It is simply a set of notes which attempt to clarify what we mean by festival calling and how it is different from traveling calling or calling one-night stands across the country, while calling on a regular basis to our home clubs and our home workshop groups. It is, furthermore, I don't think it's necessary for us to stand here and recite what is on this page. I think that you yourselves can glance through it, read the information. This being an interest session, the ideas that will be brought forth should specifically come from you. If you have any questions, if you have had any doubts in your mind as to whether or not you would like to become a festival caller or what is involved in festival calling, or if you would like to volunteer some information regarding your experience as a festival caller, we encourage you to do so during this next period of time. If you do take a look at that first page, one of the important aspects of festivals is the purpose with which the club or organization has set out to design its festival and the purpose for which the festival itself is being conducted. It's very important that we understand that there are some festivals that are merely an opportunity for people in sparsely populated areas to get together once a year and to have a real good time, just fun and relaxation. And there are some other types of festivals across the country that actually are set up in a more sophisticated basis. What they would like to do, in my opinion, is to demonstrate their area as a showcase of square dancing. They have multifaceted programs, extremely complex programs, multi-hall situations, 5, 7, 8 callers on the staff, 2 or 3 round dance couples, and it becomes a very large event, dealing perhaps in 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 dancers within that area. So in discussing festivals, let's keep in mind that they are as different as snowflakes in some cases. You have to almost define what type of festival you're talking about before you make a point regarding a specific festival. If any of you are interested in knowing about qualifications for calling it a festival, they're very vague on this paper, and they're vague for a reason. We sat down and tried to figure it out ourselves, and we had a rough time doing it. It seems to be a natural tendency for organizations to hire popular callers to do festivals. So, therefore, it becomes in your best interest to become popular, I guess, if you want to call festivals. And how do you go about doing that? Well, we went around and around on that also and decided that there are some techniques you can use. But basically, the men and the gals that are calling festivals are studied and well-disciplined in their calling presentations. They have studied their calling, and they know what they're doing. They have the ability to handle various levels and various types of groups, mixed floors. And they themselves have taken the time to expand their calling exposure by traveling through various areas and calling for a club and having the word get around that the people have enjoyed their dances. The word finally gets to the people who are responsible for setting up staffs for festivals, and the man or the gal will receive an invitation. You really can't be more specific than that, except to say that if you are interested in festivals, let the other callers who are doing festivals know about it, talk to them about it, and in this way you are in essence putting your name in the hat, because many times a festival committee will inquire of a staff member, a caller, who he thinks should be replaced or who they think they should hire for the following year, this type of thing. So, do you have anything to add to that? Mr. Flippo.
No. Farewell, sir.
Why don't we, first of all, just solicit some comments from you or some questions or from statements. What we would like to know is, first of all, what brought you to this room? Why did you come in here to... You're asking yourself the same question. What is it that you're looking for in an interest session that involves specifically festival callers? Gary? Okay. Welcome to sunny Florida. That is on tape, yes, thank you. Comment from Gary Brown of Ohio. Seriously, though, yes, sir.
Did you want questions?
Yes, it would be a good idea if you did use... Thank you, Chuck.
One of the reasons why I came in here is I've been asked to, along with a friend of mine, to go up to Detroit, New Hampshire in October to call a festival for 2 days and one night or something like that. And I've been asked also to go to a couple other festivals. And I just wanted to come find out from the experts just what the heck you do.
Okay, I'm sure we have some experts out there that would like to answer that. Don't all jump right up to that microphone at once. We only have one mic, and it's... Would anybody like to address that specific question before Marshall and I attempt to handle it? Give us some ideas so we can answer it properly.
I'm Bruce Strand from the Farm and Business Friends Association. I'm the executive of the executive, and I have recommended to our convention president that we consider doing asking for people who are really convention callers rather than traveling callers. And one of the important things being that to be able to possibly A1 and down at the least that we could do. Because we go up to C2 at our convention, and the man with A1 is going to be better mainstream two caller. We don't expect anybody to do C2 or anything like this. But we're looking for people who can are diversified. And that's one of the not a man who calls for 3 hours and that's all he knows. Does the same thing for 30 minutes in a row.
Thank you. Bruce is from the Toronto area, and he specifically is referring to the T&D convention that they have each May up there, which is a very large festival. Can all of you hear when a man steps behind the microphone? Is he coming through okay? Great. Fine. The question you had was, how do you go about finding out what this group up in New Hampshire is looking for you to do? Was this your question? I mean, you said, yes, I'll come up and do your thing, and now you're wondering what it is you're going to do?
Yes. I've got an idea, but I just want to know what possibly...
Oh, yeah, right, right. I mean, you... Right, that's understood. But what procedures have you used in the past when you've been hired to do a festival and you're going into a fresh new area? What procedures have you used to try to find out as much information as you can regarding that festival? Yes, sir. Joe?
Joe Ubelager, New York. I call callers who have been on the staff before and find out what that is, you know, what the situation is.
Same staff. Same staff.
Well,
yes.
Yeah.
Okay. That, I use that same procedure myself, especially if I'm going to a part of the country where perhaps I'm not that familiar with the dancers or what they're trying to achieve with their festival. But if you talk to callers who have done the festival in the past, they can give you the best idea of what to expect at that festival. Anybody have any other comments in that regard? We can add a lot more information to that, too. There's a lot of basic information that I like to have before I do a festival. I like to know the committee. I like to know who's sponsoring the festival, what their purpose and what their intention is in holding the festival, what their track record is, how long have they had the festival. You've seen the ones, the first annual, and then you see the ones that are 27th annual. So I like to know if there's been a track record. I like to know how many halls they're using, what levels will be on the program, how many hours will be involved in the calling schedule. Will I be expected to do any workshops? If so, at what level? Will there be specific, well-defined levels? Will they be using the Caller Lab program? Is this an event that they intend to have on an annual basis, or they have had on an annual basis? Are they expecting me to do anything special? Sometimes men are hired to come in and do a particular special type of thing. One man might be hired to come in and do singing calls, and they expect this man to put in 2 hours someplace in the program of all singing calls. Another man might be hired to do workshop material, and basically he's going to handle the bulk of the workshop material. A lot of festivals, as Bruce just pointed out, expect the callers today to be multifaceted, that they should be handling workshops at any level from A1 on down, that they should be able to handle singing calls, that they should be able to handle programs which they are alone on the stage working a whole hour, as well as integrating with round dance cures and sharing the platform with them, as well as doing work with another fellow staff caller. You might have an hour scheduled with another man. And all of these things are going to affect your programming and what you do. But this information is very readily available. And to me, it's worth a phone call to any part of the country to call the person who sent me the contract and sit down and discuss some of these items specifically with him or her, and then to pick up the phone and call another caller who has done the festival before and get his impressions of the festival. That's true. That's very true. Irv suggested that you also find out whether or not they expect you to bring sound equipment or extra sound equipment or 95 feet of speaker cord because they're going to run one speaker out in the hallway or something of this nature. Right. No, this is another thing that that Joe Ubelacker just pointed out. Know who you're going to work with. And chances are that you will be in communication somehow with another staff member sometime during the year before the festival. If not, pick up the phone and call him and say that you're interested in knowing what he's planning on doing or that type of thing. Especially if you're doing workshops, try to integrate your workshop material. The back of this page gives some very specific details on calling the festival itself, which is what we're more or less into, and it's these details are very important for festival callers to understand that even though they're hired for their proficiency and they're hired for their popularity, that they perhaps will be working with other callers who are hired for the same reason. And the ultimate purpose of that whole convention or whole festival is to provide a relaxed dancing program for the people who are in attendance. And when you're working with other staff callers, it is your responsibility to integrate your programs, your precise calling programs, and dovetail them together for the general benefit of the dancers who are in attendance. And that has always been my personal objective in calling festivals, is to find out what the festival committee has in mind in certain halls at certain time slots, so that my program is designed for those dancers in complete accordance with what the committee people themselves have as a goal or a target. Yes, sir. I will get specific permission from John Kaltenthaler on that, and we will let you know in the next issue of the direction. The question, Frank, was, can he get permission to have this copy, this page, reprinted in his local bulletin or his local area publication? An association, right. I don't think I have the authority to say yes or no. I will have to check with John Kaltenthaler. I personally don't see any problem, but let me check with him first. Does anybody have any other comments regarding, once you've been hired, once the contract comes your way, now you have a general idea of the procedure that you follow in figuring out what it is that you're to do. How many festival calls do we have in the room? And by that I mean men who call festivals regularly on an annual basis, 2-3 festivals a year maybe. Okay, some of you, ladies and gentlemen, could perhaps offer some comments and help us out, because this is a general interest session, and it's great if we could have the thoughts of people who have done this in the past, as many ideas as possible. And also some questions from those of you, how many would like, who have never done festivals before, but would like to do one? All right, what's the first question that comes to your mind? How do you get started, right? Let me toss that specific question at one of the other festival callers in the room and see how he handles it. Let's pick on Frankie Lane over here for a chance. And, Frank, the question is, I'm a new caller, and I do pretty good in my area. I think I'm pretty proficient. Now, I would like to get into the festival circuit, so to speak. I'd like to start calling some festivals. How do I get my first one?
Most of them got started by maximum cooperation with our callers' associations that we were with when they had their festival. We made sure
Frank,
they participate.
Excuse me, Frank. I hate to interrupt you, but this session is being taped. Would you please walk to the microphone? Thank you.
I think that most of us that got started doing festivals back in the beginning, we probably started by cooperating the maximum that we could with our callers' associations that we were members of. When they had festivals, we made sure to donate our time to be heard. And the only solution is being heard and having someone like what they hear. I don't know of any booking agencies, particularly in our business, or any way that you can make an application to call it the Toronto Festival or the Washington, D.C. Festival or those things. I mean, you have to wait to be asked. The only way to do that is to take every opportunity to call where the public's going to hear you. And like I say, most of us have the opportunity to call on our local area festivals, statewide festivals. There's usually a showcase there for the state caller. While I'm standing here, a couple of things that came to my mind back there of what you should also expect. I like to do, as nobody mentioned, is find out if you're expected to participate in any way or do anything in the way of after parties. This sometimes is expected of you, and you don't realize until you get there. And I don't want to throw this in as a hot potato, but probably just because I came from another session a while ago, and I think it is essential and something we shouldn't do, and it's not put up for discussion, it's a statement of fact. Check on the acceptable dress code in the area where you're going to be calling. Because they vary. If you don't travel, you don't know this. And what's very acceptable in one area might not be in another. And I think professionally, none of us are stupid enough to want to offend those that are hiring us. And so it's a good thing to check. That's one of the things you should know before you get on the plane to fly to where your festival is going to be.
Yes, very good comment. Very good. That's a real tickler situation. Why don't we just skip over that now? But it is very, very important. First of all, I think a lot of men and ladies who do festivals, usually they will go out for the big festivals and purchase one or two new outfits and so on. And you do have a tendency, therefore, to have your dress style change as you do these festivals. And it's very important to contact these people or know. The best, I think I would contact another man in the area who is not associated specifically with that festival, another caller, and ask him. This is kind of a personal type question. You certainly might feel embarrassed somewhat if you ask the committee. You might put them in an embarrassing situation. Maybe they've never thought of it before. And then they'll get tied up in a three-hour committee meeting trying to decide what you ought to wear. Bruce? You certainly cannot, in my opinion, proper, what we consider to be the proper acceptable dress, Western dress, certainly is not going to be to your detriment, but there is a tendency for men to dress fancily at festivals, and because you do have a propensity here to alter from the standard dress code, wearing suits and that type of thing, silk shirts, open necks, whatever the situation might be, there is a propensity here to vary. And that's the caution that Frank, I'm sure, wanted to bring out. There is another thing that Frank did bring out, another aspect of it, and that is doing work in your local callers association to get some experience in handling these multi-calling, multi-hauled, multi-dancing level situations with staffs of other callers, many other callers in some cases. Go ahead.
Frank Caesar from Illinois. I just might throw in, I'm in the greater St. Louis area, and our federation for their festival has, on occasion, put in their contract what they expected the caller to wear, such as a jacket for maybe the first two picks or something like that.
Yeah.
Joe Ubelacker again. I think in regards to the question about how to go about doing things is to get out there and observe, go to festivals, and specifically observe these callers and see just how it is they handle themselves.
Thank you, Joe.
John Marshall, Western Virginia. Another way that I found in getting started that seemed to work well from the standpoint of my own personal experience was getting out to the national convention. Getting up on the stage and handling big tours of people. Because a lot of fellas don't have that opportunity until the festival hits, and you know, you say you're doing a good job with your home groups, and that may be true. But how many of you are dancing 100 squares or more in your home groups on a given evening? And it's a different feeling, it's a different sensation, the crowd reactions are different, the whole empathy development is entirely different. And the National Convention is a place where they'll give you a shot at dancing, calling a big crowd. You see, you have a different feel there, it gives you a way to move it.
John brought out a very good point calling it the National Convention. Generally, most of us have called it Nationals, and you know that it's a one-shot deal. You're up there to do either a singing call or you do your patter, and that's it. And I've heard a lot of men complain about it, and they say, gosh, you know, how can I work a floor when I'm only there for 5 minutes and that type of thing? Well, the situation is not that drastic at festivals, but there is a paralleling situation. In some cases, you only have 1 hour with those people. That's four tips. And if you boot the first one and stumble on the second one and forget to do the third one, you're in a heap of trouble. And that's it. That is your time period, 1 hour. And when that hour is up, you're expected to be off the stage. And I personally know that I get offended, and I know other men get offended, when someone is on a program and he goes over his time. And you're standing up behind him, and he's 5 minutes over, and he's 10 minutes over. Sticking to the time schedule at a festival is very, very important. The committee has designed that time schedule, not you. And they expect you to stick to it as close as you can. You have 1 hour to do your thing. 1 hour. In some cases, you have a half an hour to do your thing. In one very large festival on the West Coast, all three staff callers come in for the mid-afternoon thing, and each one of them has only two tips, back-to-back. That's it. then they're done for the afternoon, and the rest of the time, the rest of the dancing is taken over by area local callers. There are different kinds of programs for different kinds of festivals, and you have to watch your time slots. Be prepared. This, I think, we can probably begin to talk about attitude and judgment right at this specific point, because your attitude is going to affect your program. And the program that you've selected is going to be a process of your judgment and the factors that you use in judging. If you are a young caller, by that I mean young exposure-wise, and this is your first big festival, you are more susceptible to errors in judgment. One thing that you cannot afford is to have any errors that you make affect your attitude. Because the attitude that you have, assuming that it is a good one, should be carried through the entire festival. It is very easy to blow a singing call. It is very easy when somebody else is handling your sound to have it just come out terrible. Isn't that right, Skip? I heard Skip do his most recent singing call is one particular year in a festival. He had just done a singing call on Top, and he was introducing it at the festival. He had a good time slot. The hall was packed. He had a sound engineer way up in the balconies of this ice skating rink. Sound engineer had earphones on, a small portable TV, and was watching a hockey game. And Skip did his brand new singing call, a cappella. And went right through it. Didn't bat an eyelash. Those dancers danced to that whole singing call, and the only one who heard the music were the people, the two or three squares right up front, who happened to have access to a monitor speaker, which did have the music coming out. The rest of the floor, no music. All they heard was Skip. Skip just drove it out. You can't back up at that point in the program, you know. So these are the things. You can't let these things affect your attitude. It's easy to walk off and say, there it is. You know, that was my hot spot, down the drain. I'm gone. I'm done. It's all over. You can't let that happen. I never analyze a festival until I get home on Monday, till that thing is completely done. I just make a point. I don't care. Boy, I know I blow it. I knew I did, but that's it. It's a draft in the back of the hall.
No, what's happened to Skip happened to me one time, only it's different. I could hear the music, and about the first three or four squares could hear the music because it's a band. But the speakers were way out in the middle of the Coliseum, and the voice come back to you after you said, bow to your partner. Well, actually, Bob Osgood in here, I was going to MC the next session at this festival, and he introduced me. He is the MC before that. And I says, thank you, Bob, and nothing came out. And I said, this damn thing, and then it started coming back. And the whole thing came back. But many funny experiences. Not so funny at the time. But, boy, I tell you, sometimes you can't take yourself too seriously. Mistakes. I'm prone to make a lot of mistakes. And if I let them bother me, I'd really be in bad shape now. But I think, like Kip says, you got to be ready for everything. And if you see something happening that's real bad, well, you think, well, this is happening to me now, so it happened to everybody else. Well, or maybe it doesn't happen to everybody else, but surely, I'm sure at times you're going to run into places that where you've wish to heck you could get out there, and you can't. And you just, like Skip says, you got to kind of forget it and go ahead. Somebody say something. No.
I have one question, and I've heard of things that have come back from different festivals, and most of these things that come back, and I know most of the callers that call these festivals, people have come back and said, well, I'm not going back to that festival again. And I said, well, why? And they said, well, we went in a workshop that afternoon. We got in there that night, and they clobbered us with the things they tried to teach us that afternoon. Now, what's your opinion on that?
Well, we have two different sets of opinion on it. We have, at times, if there's not too many come in at the night session, we do have a tip at night. We say that this was taught this afternoon for the people that did care enough to show up. maybe I shouldn't say care enough or were able to show up. And we'll do a tip and use the workshop material that we used. And we tell the other people beforehand that this tip will be used. Maybe a tip beforehand or two tips beforehand. Keep reminding them that it'll be a workshop tip that was used that afternoon in the workshop. If the crowd is increased too much at night, I really try to talk the committee out of it, or the chairman. I don't really try to talk them out of it because they're going to pay me. But I do suggest that, you know, maybe there's too many people that are here now that was not here in the afternoon to have a tip, a workshop tip. But that's, I don't think I'd ever try to call it without warning. Like you say, they go away clobbered. I don't, you mean the stuff that was used in the workshop was used all night long. Well, no, I don't think I'd ever do that.
No, what's that? They went to the workshop, and then they went to the dance that night. You know, it takes a while to learn.
Oh, sure, I see what you mean, yeah. And they wasn't slowed down. In other words, they had maybe a workshop tip, and they just, I see. Yeah. Bruce?
Marshall, I've heard the same effect from dancers that went someplace and said they workshopped the afternoon, and then they didn't call
it. Yeah, true. Yeah, that's right. Why don't you say something about that? Don't go away.
Don't sit here.
The situation at multi-staff type festivals where you have many callers can create a headache. You have three callers who are responsible for doing a workshop. Each one's going to do part of the afternoon workshop. One goes from 1 to 2, the next one goes from 2 to 3, and the last one goes from 3 to 4. Well, while each workshop is going on, each man might be off in another hall working while man B is over in the workshop doing the workshop. And consequently, by the time the dancers have done that three-hour workshop, each man has presented two new moves. That's six calls, 3 hours. And then you have your evening program rolling around, and the question is, what gets called at the evening dance? Very serious problem. Now, that's just defining the problem, and I think you can all agree that there is a problem there. And what I would like to know is, how has this been handled by you in the past at festivals that you've called? Anybody want to volunteer a reply there? Carl? No, you don't want to volunteer a reply.
Yeah.
Okay, here comes Frankie Lane. Yeah, we should.
In answer to your question, I think that Flip touched upon it a moment ago, and the fact that if you are going to use workshop material during a tip, I think it should be pre-announced. I think most people that come home unhappy from a convention or a festival come home unhappy because they have been misled, either thinking they were going to get more or not be pushed quite as hard. Another thing that needs solving when you're working, as Kip just mentioned, with a variety of other callers on the staff that you're introducing material, if you're not present, I think the staff at their meeting should exchange the workshop material they're going to do to make sure that the other callers understand that material so that they are asked questions about it. I like to know what Kip introduced, but I don't want to come off stupid by saying, I never heard that, but, you know, I like to be able to answer someone's question about it. They can't find him, or they want to ask something. So I think the callers that are working together should exchange material that way. Another one, clear off the subject, is often in my mind back there that I've seen festival callers, they shouldn't. In answer to the first question that came up about what do I do now, don't make the mistake that a lot of newer festival callers seem to make. Don't book yourself in on the last plane that can arrive to get you there in time. Come to the festival site early in the morning and take your nap there. Too often you're embarrassed, the festival committee are embarrassed because some emergency comes up late and you cannot arrive. So get there as soon as you can. Do your resting at that end of the trip.
That's a good point. You're going to make another one, too.
Things we've found, maybe not, I'm not so familiar up east, but out west or midwest, we've found, and the areas that I'm more familiar with, and basically know or have been to the festival before, kind of know what they're going to dance, if they're going to dance mainstream and the quarterly selections. a few guys, and myself included, have been trying to, instead of teaching some experimental list, go to the plus one list and teach them something off of that. Or if they're dancing plus one, we teach them something off of plus two. Very seldom we hit a festival out in there anyway that's dancing. Too many people are dancing up in the A's. We have, you know, rooms for that. But as what I'm trying to say is we have like two caller festivals where each caller is at the workshop, each caller's at the dance that night. And we try to teach something off of the list that is above what they are dancing. Of course, some of them probably had it, but the majority of them that wouldn't not have something off the plus one, we would teach something off the plus one, whereas we're very sure that they're going to see this movement again.
We have to be very flexible, too. Some areas require that we do teach an experimental. Some workshops are defined as experimental workshops. Other workshops have a defined level where they expect you to take something from an existing list, the next list above, and work it. Other types of workshops and committees expect you, if you're calling a mainstream plus one workshop, that you only work mainstream plus one material. So it is different, and again, this is where communication comes in. Another aspect I'd like to just get on, and this might have something to do with attitude also, is don't find yourself in a position of competing with other staff callers when you're calling a festival. It's very, very easy to do. It's very easy to feel that another man is competing with you and then to pick up the microphone and go one better. I can honestly say in the festivals that I've done that the men just don't compete. They don't. They get up and they do whatever it is that they do, and they do it really well. And then you should get up and do whatever it is you do and do it as best that you can. When you do workshops, in some cases, there is what we call a follow-up routine, where if you're doing back-to-back workshops and a man has just worked Make Me a Column, you might come in there and as you introduce your figure to work, throw in the Make Me a Column as we go along. And this is nothing to do with competition. This is something else at all. This is dovetailing the program for the benefit of the dancers, which is what we're really there for. And so it's very easy to fall into that trap of competing with another caller on the staff, but I will tell you honestly that I can even tell you a story that a festival I was calling once with Burl Main and Gary Shoemaker, I believe, and there was another man on the staff, and it was the first time any of us had ever worked with this man, and he was up there, and the three of us were in the back of the hall watching him move the floor, and we thought he was doing a great job, just a fabulous job. And then all of a sudden we saw him get into trouble, a little bit of trouble. We knew that he couldn't find his corner and that here he had 100, 125 squares in front of him and he's moving them and you can almost see the sweat breaking across his forehead. And each one of us individually, we started thinking, you know, looking across the floor and we made our own decisions as to what he ought to do, never said anything. And we'd say, oh, there he goes. He's got it now. Look at that. Oh, no, wait a minute. Here he goes. And when he got out, the three of us just went, we're crazy. And this is the general attitude that you have with festival callers. They really do like to work well together, and it's such a tremendous feeling of accomplishment. Gloria, you generally have some very good ideas, and along the lines that we've been discussing so far, is there anything that you'd like to add? Okay.
Delaware Valley, the T&D, and I think some other festivals, all of them had a space where you could volunteer call. That is gone completely. Now it's not open. Pardon?
Toronto still has it, yeah.
I don't come to volunteer anymore, please.
Montreal has it, too, I do believe.
All right. Okay. Those are a little far from the majority of the people I think are in this room. All right. And in New England, we decided that there were a lot of fellows that couldn't go to these things in the bird, so we decided to have our own, and we started, and it worked out pretty good. And now we're just the New England Convention, actually, which is, as you know, still done by the New England College. That has not changed. When we went to Nova Scotia, there was nothing being done in the way of a festival. And so we submitted the idea of having a festival in which just the local college association would run. And we did that. It's been done 10 years now, and it's still being done. And every once in a while, the thought comes up, hey, let's get in a top-name caller. But if callers want to learn, and their wives, it really gives the spouses or partners a chance to participate. The association up there runs entirely the whole thing. The callers, wives, take in registrations, greet people at the door. It is their responsibility to do many things in connection with that, and they really feel part of it. It's a great experience. The whole area is drawn together because who is it that whose dancers support? Whose dancers support these conventions anyway? It isn't the local callers. So we moved to Pennsylvania, and I submitted this at the last, Delaware Valley is asking to have volunteer callers. It's a great resentment in this day and age. Hey, they want our dancers. They want us to come and pay to go to the convention, and they also want to have our, you know, time taken up by calling in a little hall stuck off at the worst possible time. So we are going to have a convention in our area, and I happen to be chairman of that convention, but it is working. It has worked twice now and developed into real good things because all these guys that have never had a chance can't do it. They might consider going back to their association and back there.
Good idea. Well, the clock is coming around on us, and I know that at 5 o'clock we have another meeting in this room, which is that open invitation that you found in your packet regarding some problems that clubs are having. So we're going to start working downhill a little bit, and the last specific aspect of festival calling, I think, that we haven't really discussed yet, are some of the surprises that you get. Some of those things, they say the best laid plans of mice and men. You go in there with your program all set, and all of a sudden, it happens. It, capital IT, parentheses, quotation mark, exclamation point. There are so many little variable things that happen, and I think, Flip, you want to discuss one, right? Don't you remember that gal?
No.
I mean, the one who got her petticoat caught in your mic cord right in the middle of that singing call. Darn near pulled the equipment off the table, you know. All kinds of things do happen. What I would like to do is, first of all, just ask some of the fellows who have done the festivals, what stands out in your mind is that one thing that you really least expected, and then boom, it happened. That's Jimmy Lee. Where, is Jimmy here? Where's Jimmy? Jim. Jimmy, will you use the microphone, please? Jimmy Lee from Canada.
I had an experience at the CD convention last year, my first time in the room, working on A1 program. And I worked all season long on a group, basement group, working on the A1 program. And my Tom Maurer comes in. I'm up there, and all of a sudden, I'm all set to go. I'm in my program, and the machine quits. And the hydro goes, and you're standing there, and all of a sudden, what do you do? And I tell you, it was an awful experience. The selector started to roll, and the executive had to run again the machine, and I just sort of sat there and took a couple deep breaths, and then all of a sudden, when the new machine came in, I just got up there and got back into it again. But I tell you, it was an awful experience. You're all supposed to go your first chance, and no hydro. And it's gone.
Right, hydro is power. Right. Usually that happens right after two couples have just come up to talk to you. One of them is the representative from the Delaware Valley Federation, and the other one is another representative from some other federation. They both have big festivals, and they've just about told you that you are now being scrutinized. And boom, there goes the power. Hydro. Okay, how about some other experiences? Yes.
Lake Falls, New Jersey. I'm not a festival caller per se, but at the national convention, it was in Oklahoma few years ago, and I was in ready to do a workshop half hour, and I had the pattern record on. I was all set, and everybody was going. We had already started our intro figure. We had started dancing. We were actually into the pattern pulse, so they came and removed the amplifier.
Incredible. Just incredible. That, there is probably no way I could not let that affect my attitude.
Did he get permission?
Yes.
Bob Barnes from Florida. I just recently, last week, was down in Panama Canal Zone, and they danced a mainstream and quarterly selection down there. So I was asked to work some workshop something. I was using teacup change. And I looked out on the floor, and there seemed to be a little problem. The four of the squares weren't doing anything. The next time I explained it, they did. I found out they only speak Spanish. It was a Costa Rican congregation, and they had to watch whatever I taught the people in English. Laugh. You should have such good sense. These people, seriously, watched the English-speaking people. The first time, they did nothing but watch. The second time, they attempted. The third time they made it, the English speaking were still crying.
John Marshall again. Calling the Richmond Festival this fall. It was terrific. The sound was atrocious. Nobody could hear anything. None of the Eagles would handle the records properly. We kept getting skips in the middle of the singing call and setting them back. We had totaled up about 35 cents in coin on top of the phone lines, trying to hold them down. And we had no monitors. We had no monitors working. And we had a stage about the one you thought was kind of here, a little bit longer. And the speakers were set out to the far ends and no monitors. We couldn't hear our music because the speakers were set in front of us. So we had to move out to the outside edge of the stage. We had approximately 50 squares, I guess, on the floor. Just that time I was right in the midst, really, really moving for a corner, really working. The crowd was starting to feel the surge, starting to boost my volume. Stage collapsed on me.
That's better than getting
a floor call. You can do
that. If you and Mike Foley call on the same festival, let us know. That should be a real catastrophe. And get Dave, yes.
No, 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 no. He's got one little tip, really. It's nothing too serious, but if you're not watching the other boy, it was really bad. Catch it. If at the end of the evening you're catching the light and you don't start it off, I would advise you to be sure and pick a square. That guy had me, so thoroughly confused. He didn't know where he was. Said, well, that's it. Turn, hand me the mic and jump off stage.
Your turn. There are some hot mic sessions, and we do have a blast about that here at the end of the sessions, too. And those hot mic sessions can really be a lot of fun. The committee more or less expects all the staff callers to participate somehow. However, they can be somewhat of a drag, too, if you get my message. They have to be well-constructed and well-programmed. You just can't do what seems to be the right thing sometimes because you're in a playful mood. And I'm speaking specifically of a festival that we happen to be doing this most recent year, where we had a clever idea. There were seven calls in the staff, and we decided that each man would take one call. And we had three different microphones plugged into this one unit, and all seven of us lined up across the stage, and one man, he'd do it, and he'd get to the next man, he'd take the next call. It started out pretty good, but then we had another microphone coming down the other direction, and the first three middle guys had usually two mics going either way, and by the time it was their turn, they had no mic to work with because all the mics were at the end. The mics got all tied up in a knot. The people were tied up in a knot. And we were virtually holding a 15-minute music appreciation session. But it was an experience. Did anybody else have anything to add?
You know, one of the more serious items is there a procedure for when someone has something go wrong, like a heart attack or something like that?
No, listen, this is very serious. You know, we as leaders should recognize our responsibility. CPR is usually offered in all of our communities by our fire departments or our Red Cross or something. And after, I've had three fatal heart attacks at my dances, at my clubs. And after the second one, I decided that I'd go down and learn CPR. I mean, there's just no two ways about it. Now, that's just a side note. It doesn't answer your question, Joe, but I just want to throw that out and inject it. Seriously, consider yourself in a situation where you could save someone's life. And it does happen. It happened to me just as recently as last September. So, now, the question is, somebody hits the floor. Somebody has a coronary, a massive heart attack, or a stroke, something of that nature. What do you do? How is it handled? I'm sure that we all have a basic procedure that we follow, standard amongst all of us, but maybe if we heard some personal experiences on how you handle it yourself, we could get some better ideas on it. Okay, Joe?
Well, the reason I brought it up was because one of our called Christmas dances, we had a man leave a little bit early because of chest pain, and he got off the street and started having a heart attack. We happened to have about seven people in the group who were trained with CPR, and there's certain situations where you don't use that, and his was one of them. Someone else called the police. They came and they proceeded to drag him out of the car and administer it and in fact kill him. And, but my problem at the point was his partner had come down as I was hollering for an ambulance, and that's what he was saying, heart attack or not. It has happened where the person was on the floor and called ambulance. And my procedure is, as long as I can see and my peripheral vision that someone is taking care of it, I'm relatively sure, and in these groups that these happen, I knew what people could hear it. I kept on calling to keep attention away from it. And the quickest thing that we've developed is get the person out. Have them leave by ambulance. It doesn't matter. They know he's dead right there. You know, yeah, I suppose out of sight, out of mind to some extent. But keep going and finish it as normal. I don't know what it
was. Anybody else have anything to add to that or reemphasize?
Find out where the closest telephone is and the emergency phone number in case of emergency.
Of course, you've got to realize that if you administer that CPR, you are then responsible for that person's life or death.
All of this comes out in a good CPR course.
Kids,
right.
It's not worth walking over for, but the Rochester Area College Association this month are having some sort of a shortened course where their association has hired
Person. Yeah. Okay. The point being that, for the sake of the tape, that local regional college association and dancers associations themselves are sponsoring CPR courses for their members. Right. This aspect of keeping people moving can be terrible when you have that microphone in your hand, especially if the person is close to you. This happened in the most recent situation I had. That person was right there, right? It depends on the situation, too. Yeah, right. That's right. In some cases, you have to continue, and yet you have to recognize the fact that if this was the club president or somebody who is extremely active in the club and known by everybody in the hall, you're not going to be able to carry on for more than 2 minutes before those people are just going to ignore you and start crowding around. And that is the purpose of continuing, is to keep them or avoid the situation where they crowd the injured person.
Just another quick point about power going off, the entire power going off while the dancers are on the floor, and no light, no emergency backup. What to do in that case?
Yes, that's another critical situation where you lose all your power. You want me to comment on it? Yeah. If you have to tell them to yell rock at that stage, your people are different from mine. No, but that is a serious situation. You've lost your power. You can't use the microphone. You know, I mean, you can't just make an announcement, please stay where you are, or anything of that nature. The power is gone. I suppose you could holler at the top of your voice if you wanted to and keep them in line that way. These various situations that do come out of festivals, I'd like to tell you something else, too. Please avoid this if you are a young, anxious caller, and you just completed your hours or your hour or your time slot, and the next man gets up to call, and he's in the middle of his patter or he's in the middle of a singing call, and you want to unplug your microphone. Well, this happens, let me say. And 9 times out of 10, that needle's going to skip. And you have just interfered with this program and probably caused some hard feelings. So avoid this type of a situation, too. Anybody have anything else to add? Yes. Thank you. We are winding down, and with this next comment, let me just say that if you came here with a specific purpose or a specific question, please come to the microphone and ask it now, all right, so that we can have somebody answer it for you.
My name is Model Area. Our panel discussion to participation in the panel, the part of the thing you should find out what happens before you go, or is this something you expected, or is this a problem in the festival college?
Yes, it is. The problem being that some committees expect you to, for instance, conduct a caller's clinic as part of your contract, or expect you to conduct or sit in a information or education seminar of some type, either dancer or otherwise. I don't see it as a specific problem unless you know ahead of time or you're unaware that you're supposed to do it. You get there and you're totally unprepared. And then they spring it on you. A lot of these questions can be answered when you sign your agreement to call for these festivals. I know that personally, I type a letter. I not only sign the pre-printed and pre-written contract or whatever it is, but I also put a cover letter with it. And if I have any questions, the questions are contained in that cover letter. I just don't slip their copy of the contract into an envelope, put 15 cents on it, and drop it in the mail. I always send some sort of a cover letter with those return contracts. And in that letter, you could specify, I'm probably going a step further because my personal procedure is I won't sign the contract unless I know specifically what I'm doing, which should be in their preface letter or their invitational letter, what they expect you to do, how many hours of calling, and so on. But anyway, I don't see any problem as long as we're aware of the fact that this does happen and you should inquire about it. Anybody else?
Anybody else got anything? Everybody know how to call? Am I?
Mike Foley, from New Jersey. One other question. Generally, at a festival, does the caller charge the festival, or does the festival offer a fee?
Some offer fees, and some ask you how much. What do I... Why am I up here? Let's see, my wife knows. Don't you know? She don't know.
The answer is yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah, is there somebody here that has a good policy on that? I kind of know what we do, but I'd have to talk to my wife. Well, she says something, you know, if there's other callers, she says something that's not any less than other callers, or, you know, not any more, but not for sure less. But if they're paying them $75, I want $75. Bruce? Okay, Bruce going to tell you what TND does.
The Toronto District Association usually has two levels of colors, an A color and a B color, and they have a set fee. They send you a contract offering, you have your thoughts on, and the fee is with that letter. You accept that at that price, or you don't accept it, you ask them for more, they'll turn you down. It's a set fee.
Right.
They don't say whether it's the A fee or the B fee.
No, they don't say whether it's A fee. You have a set fee, and that's your fee. Now, quite often, a man may come in the first time as a B caller, the second time as a B-caller, and they can't use no second, but he's an A caller.
I see.
So there is a set fee, and they won't hang over.
The A and B caller has nothing to do with his ability. It's just a surprise.
First time he's making some cases new to the area.
I see. Thank you, Bruce. Okay, Kip.
One thing, transportation is offered both ways, lodging and food. Two, man, and the king of some ways, two persons.
I'll take it.
Along these lines about fees, if you're in doubt, find out from either another man who's hired to do the same thing, or find out from another man or gal that has done it in the past. Many of the festivals will write you and say, you know, we are the Flower Fest of some place, and we would like you to come and call our festival. It'll be Friday night and all day Saturday and Saturday night. What is your fee? To answer a letter like that, I try to find out as best I can who's done that thing in the past. You know, sometimes I'll call them on the telephone and ask them. You know, I think I have the date open. I have another letter out on it right now, and I don't know exactly if I can make it or not, but could you give me some more information so that when I find out, I can answer your letter properly? That type of thing. And another thing to remember is, as much as you want to do a festival, I don't think that it's fair as a professional caller for you knowingly to come in under the wire to get yourself on the staff, that type of a thing. If a staff, if a committee is used to paying $100 plus round-trip airfare plus accommodations, it's really not very fair for you to approach that committee and say, I'll do it for $99, forget about the airfare, give me one meal and I'll take care of my own room. That's not fair. That's an exaggeration, but there are situations where, and thank God they are rare, there are situations where certain individuals historically have attempted to buy themselves onto a festival. It doesn't work. It doesn't work, because if you're not really accepted enough as a caller to get the invitation in the mail like everybody else, buying your way on is not going to help at all. Anybody else have anything to add before we wrap? No. I hate to be facetious, but really they vary, vary so much. There are some festivals that have a limited capacity. They can only take 800 dancers. Therefore, they can only afford to pay $350 plus your expenses. But they expect you to call as much as the other festival that has 6,000 dancers will pay you $500 or pay you $600 plus your expenses. It's sometimes unfair on our part to say, I can't leave my house for less than $600. Okay? Because really what you're saying is your festival is not big enough for me. And that's tough. So the answer to your question is no. There is no hard and fast rule. Communicate with other men who have done it, and they will tell you on an individual basis what each festival is used to paying. Anybody else? Have you two been properly introduced?
Now that I'm no longer a festival caller. Along with Bruce, do you pay an American currency or Canadian currency? I lost a lot of money last year in Montreal.
That's an important question.
It is.
Americans are paid in American currency.
Canadians are paid in
Canadian
currency.
It's a controversial question in Canada, but the Americans are paid in American currency.
That's stipulated by contract, too.
No, I got to kid Bruce a little bit. This is true. That's the way they do it. Now. I think I worked the first three Toronto conventions when the exchange rate was in favor of U.S. currency, and I was always paid in Canadian. Next time I worked up there was one of those years when it was about 6 or 7% in favor of Canadian currency. I got paid in U.S. I've seen about ever since. It wasn't a big deal.
I like to ask a question of somebody and see what y'all might have handled it, or whether it's ever come up. But it's come up twice in the last year for me, and they asked my plane fare, and then it really kind of bothered me too, because I'm really not after the money. I lie a lot, but I would not cheat anybody out of a dollar as far as that goes. But twice this year, I've had my plane fare questioned, and one time I explained them to the they thought I was coming from another area. What happened was they changed chairman in between. The chairman that had hired me had to move out, and eventually he didn't move out. He stayed there, but they had another chairman. Well, during the last tip I was calling, he come up between the singing call and the hash call and says, "Here's your money, and your expenses is not here." And I says, "Well," he says, "the treasurer's already gone." And you know, this is a festival. And he says, "Here's your," I says, "Well, okay." I said, "Just send expenses to you." "Well," says, "we found your expense letter was $100 more than what we found." I said, "What you found? What do you mean?" He said, "Well, from this area to this area and back again is, we'll say, $180. It says, you said it's $280. I said, "Yeah, but I've got to go $50 more another way and $50 more another way to get to this area that you're talking about." "Oh," he said, "I didn't know that." Well, before the singing call was over, he is back with a check for the other my expenses. He said, "I caught the treasurer in the parking lot." Well, now the other one was, they said they kept on wanting my expense. Well, I didn't have it with me. I said, "Well, I don't know what my plane fare was. I'll call my wife to be sure." So I called her. She gave me the price, and they paid me $10 less. I told them what it was, and they paid me $10. Now, whether they checked and found out that some way it was $10 less, or they just wanted to pay me $10 less, I have no idea. But it made me feel like they felt like I was cheating them out of $10 or something. So how would anybody come up against a thing like this?
Just recently, in the Saskatoon area, Martin Miller, we had a festival. We found, in hiring the cause of this festival, that it was cheaper for us to buy his plane ticket in Canada and send it to him rather than have him buy it down there. Two reasons. Our fare, for some reason, was $15 cheaper. We also got a 20% exchange because we're buying Canadian money.
Well, neither one of these places I'm talking about was in Canada. It's right here in the U.S.
I know of one incident, Marshall, where a caller, and I think it has been spread among the through Legacy, or, you know, I'm not knocking on it, they have an avenue for here in Greenland, and if I'm not mistaken, at some point, a caller went and charged a large amount of money and did, in effect, come from about 50 miles away, and they took it as if he was coming from his furthest point, which is clear across country.
Yeah, that's
wrong. And I think that they're gun shy now. And so
I see. But why? You know, even though they question you, the two chairmen that I'm talking about, where the $100 discrepancy was, were, you know, this resolved out okay, you know, after they found out. One thought I was coming from one area. The first chairman knew where I was coming from. So that was, but it was kind of funny that he found the treasure in the parking lot. So
I think this goes back to something that Kip brought out earlier in the meeting, though. It's a matter of getting all these things in the contract specified, because with the instance Gloria mentioned, we have all worked both ways. Some contracts read from the preceding date to the following date. Some of them are from your home to the destination and back to your home. It doesn't say you have to leave from home. It says we will pay your airfare from home to here to home. That's a financial agreement. What I go to the airlines and I get the price of tourist fare, which they usually specialize. They don't fly in first class anymore. I get the tourist fare from Denver, Colorado to wherever it is and back. And if I happen to fly in west or further, because it happens the other way too, I may be flying in another $80 or $90 the other side of there, but they're not obligated to get me there. So I think it's a matter of setting it up in advance just to avoid misunderstandings. And then carrying it, if you can get a receipt from the airline or from your travel agency, depending on how you do your booking, those things certainly help.
Let me just say along that same line that they should expect to pay the regular tourist airfare round trip. In order to pick up some of these super savers and some of the K-class excursion rates, there are certain stipulations, and some of those stipulations cannot be met until the last minute by a traveling caller. I don't know if I'm going to be home in time on Friday to catch that exact flight that has the K-class special fare to it in order to get me to that city. I might have to take whatever plane is available when I'm ready to get on it. And that means that I have to pay, in most cases, point-to-point or standard tourist class airfare.
Sir, say that a local caller or a regional caller is president of the Callers Association, and he hires two national callers to come in and call a multi-level dance. So the levels are identified in big print on the rooms that the dancers are entering, and either one or both of the callers are varying from the list. How do you, as a local yokel, such as myself, tell a top-named national caller that he's not staying in the list and you prefer they would?
Yeah. Either that, yeah, and I would never have him back again.
You hired him, you tell him.
Yeah, and you're the boss, really. And you're no little guy either.
One sure way to make him stay with it, have him on his shoulder and say, would you like your check after you finish?
Like you said, would you like your check when you hit? Say, before Kip finishes this up here, I would like to say that it's terrific working with an articulate type of terrific individual. I'm really being serious now. And he's the one that he put my name on his handout here, which I was glad to see my name on there because I think that's a terrific thing. But he put my name before his, and he done all this. And I think you ought to give him a job for hand for a terrific job. And his name is what? Kip Gave. Kip Gave.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. And we hope that you've enjoyed this whole session on the interest session on festival callers. If you have, indicate so, and we'll provide you with